challenge that it is through.
Great. And Kevin, when you're working with your clients, how do you help them manage the tension between innovation and risk and getting that balance right and working with the public sector to kind of do that? I think it's one of those challenges in the innovation space.
Innovation really does promise a lot of hope. Diane's presentation just before really showed the way we can think about things differently. But doing things differently also comes with risk. And it comes with risk for firms and it comes with risk for employees. And that sort of risk for firms is the operational risk that going out and leading, that no one else has tried before, all those sorts of things. So I think the way you deal with that is you take very targeted propositions and say, okay, I'm going to work on this and all the programs that are for regulators, the challenge is actually not here, because I think that as innovation moves through and changes the way that financial services are delivered in society, you still need regulation to be a good for consumers and the stability of the system. And so in doing so, you need to make sure that as innovation is developed, that it doesn't create any problems like that. Systemic stability, unfair consumer outcomes, all those sorts of things, the reasons we have regulation. And our title for this topic is Charting the Course. And I think groups like MAS are certainly leading the way here in this forum. It's one of the critical aspects of needing to stay close to and involved in the regulation. There's only a handful of regulators around the world that are doing that. Let's give credit. That's from Australia, that's good. We're also charting the course passes the ACA. Once you get through that, there's not a lot of regulators that are fully engaged to the extent that they should at present in this space.
And John, that's one of the things that at the IIF we've seen as a challenge is looking at the technical regulatory frameworks and how technologies like blockchain and AI and other new tools are moving into that space. So as you are getting ready to bring out how an offering to advise people how to use that, really again moving into space, finding that balance in the blockchain has been a bit of a challenge and the pendulum has swung quite a bit over the past couple of years. So what are you seeing? What are you doing?
Yeah, the last people that did the panel before, there was a lot of discussion around identity. Clearly, you know, everyone's all over the automated AI, KYC, train, that's a is on that journey, but it needs to be applied in such a way that when you do pass a particular stage gate of compliance, that the digital certificate is issued for that and is applied to a specific, you know, whatever browser or whatever you may have that's actually tapping into that blockchain. You know, we work on an economic basis, you know, they issue this because we run NIP75 related payments protocols. All of these things come together around identity on the wallet, that's probably one of the main issues that we've been focused on over the last 12 months. You know, we were just chatting over there about as we create new native digital currencies and they become more and more affluent, more and more prevalent, I should say, in the Asian markets and around the world. As we create and destroy those coins, you know, the process of doing that is really uncharted. Yes, we can follow digital cash rules that come out of the UK or other locations. You know, organizations like myself, I think that only would be hugely valuable if we could help us have some of the stands on creation and destroying coins on those sort of platforms as we go through.
We'll see what we can do. So Craig, as you look at these working, you're trying to bring together the full ecosystem, how are you prioritizing the places where you're using your own 70 hours of each day? How are you prioritizing where new clients and the public sector really need to focus their effort?
Well, I guess a big chunk of our focus at the moment is actually trying to get people to embrace the new technology. And a certain part of that is a cultural change. A lot of organizations we speak to about this, potentially rather selfish concern about, is this actually going to cost me my job? And so it's sort of working through and getting people to, you know, first off understand, no, it's not, you're still going to need people to drive these things, you need to set a strategy. It's really, it's going to take away a lot of mundane tasks that you do and replace them by potentially a robot to do it. So that's part of it. I think that's, you know, Kevin's point around regulations, getting involved. A very good example is here with the MAS and the use of the cloud. I mean, a lot of the stuff we're talking about today is not new, it's been around for a few years, but I know that I'm going to talk to clients here over the last few years around, you know, cloud-enabled solutions and technology such as that. It was very much a reluctance because the regulator hadn't initially come out and endorsed it. It hasn't, you couldn't use it, and you applied it probably could, but it was just, you know, a deep mistrust around it. As soon as the MS came out and said, yep, outsourcing requirements, cloud is all good, the amounts of requests and, you know, inquiries around cloud-based technology and managed type services and using these is just, isn't tenfold, I'd say. So I think that the regulation embracing that technology and actually understanding getting the message out is quite important to getting that culture change down to, I guess, the industry in general to start embracing
it. And Kevin, as you look at, I think that that touches on sort of the skill set of the future. What are those skills that you found or that you're advising clients or working here on the board?
Well, I think it's a combination. I think certainly, we've already heard today around the exponential need for data scientists and people to be covered. And as we saw last night, those of the awards, they're starting young as well. With sleeping stage and learning stage really impressing everyone. And I think that there's certainly a need for that, but I think there is also a need for the people overlay in terms of strategy. So, developing that product. Developing a business case and a platform in which you can make change and to integrate that into a business strategy is just as important, if not more important. And so I think that you're going to need people who are thoughtful, can actually look at these issues and say, this can change my business and help my business as well. And it can change my business as well. I can go into these markets, I can do all these things, and you do that in a way with different mindset to the way we have run financial institutions in the last few decades. Of course, you know, it has been a real estate. And if you think about the way financial institutions have been run, the business of banking and insurance and asset management, or the technology is made fast as a fundamental change. And now we're about to enter a period of fundamental change. And given that, you need a different mindset about business. So you need fresh energy.
And drilling down a little bit on RegTech, so if you think, John, for instance, about the regulatory compliance implications of the blockchain solutions that you're building, what are some of the benefits, tools that the public sector really should be perhaps focused on a little more? If you think about, you know, the intent of the regulation, having those new tools, maybe providing channels to achieve.
Yeah, look, I personally believe that the Vulcan digital asset services business that we have will probably have more success in the government and public sector in the first instances than it will potentially even in five market sectors. The one of the most important parts about wallets and, you know, connecting blockchain and creating native digital coins is it gives you the ability to release programmable money. It allows you to create contextual money and smart money. Because the wallets that we're creating and using on the Vulcan platform allow us to say where, when, how, and why that digital coin can be spent. So from a governmental perspective, when they say, hey, you know, $100 million from a government aid foundation goes to Haiti, you know, unfortunately about $80 million of that $100 million actually gets to, you know, the people that need it on the ground. If we can digitize that in terms of creating and minting our own conversions of Bitcoin or stablecoin pegged to various cryptocurrencies, clearly we can give people wallets that allow them to spend it in certain ways, and we can stop all that fraud from occurring. So, you know, the smart money program in the money space is going to be massive for governments for sure, and that's just one use case of multiple where they actually want people to spend money in a certain way for a certain reason, and not squander it potentially or have some sort of fraudulent machine around.
Yeah, maybe, you know, if I'll pose to the entire panel and jump in a little bit and pay with each other, but what are some key requirements of good, of what a good bank tax solution could be?
I'll jump in. So,
solution to the problem that we've got in front of us. And therefore, I think that where RegTech somewhat differs from FinTech is that FinTech is about the blue sky. It really is about what's the art of the possible in the way that we can do financial services in the future. RegTech, to use that analogy, more as where the blue sky meets the horizon, it's where the rubber meets the road, because these are the real problems right now. The compliance spend at banks, it's not an understatement, that's out of control. And even though it's out of control, I'm not sure there's a greater confidence that spend is actually So I think with RegTech, a good RegTech solution is one that makes management of a firm and regulation of a firm better. And those sorts of solutions will solve the problems of legacy systems, will solve the problems of data storage, data manipulation, data presentation, it will solve the problem of management. It will so that we start using 700-400 page management decks once a month. Or it's something that many people digitally can touch and feel. And that's where the real benefits of RegTech come out. And that's why it's a little bit different from the FinTech space. And I also share with you that this is a time sort of for RegTech to break away from FinTech in some sense because it's a different paradigm. And I think there are things that will change, so blockchain and AI, more digitalized to other companies, but it's solving real problems. I think the real solution is
Sure.
Yeah, I was going to say, I think that the solution is very apt in that you know, a lot of the better solutions we're seeing as well is actually a combination of technologies. It's not just that one solution is necessarily trying to share the problems, but I think it's putting a number of them together. And as I said, that could be the use of the cloud, could be the use of artificial intelligence. It's really putting that package together so that you can reduce the costs, you can automate, you can leverage the benefits of the technology to really go out and take that additional data and put in and use it. As I said, you know, getting a report so that you can drop your iPad and start to drill down in specific areas that you want to do, it's going to be very valuable. I think having more real-time compliance, you know, people with reliable rate setting issues and things like that, and I think some of the analytics, voice analytics and data mining tools that we have these days, so yeah, getting the solution, getting all the package together, I think is quite critical.
I also just reiterate from all the conversations through the last few minutes, standards. Which brings us actually to our first question from Pigeonhole, and a reminder of the audience to submit questions that we have for our panel. So the first question is, how do you see consultants playing a role in standardizing regulatory compliance across banks and regulators in an increasingly complicated and complex
probably just two comments. The first one, the regulators in Sydney in Australia, absolutely fantastic. We've got some asset guarding rules, some asset guarding rules, track RBA. Absolutely fantastic in supporting and wanting to get engaged and integrated into day-to-day use of new technologies. Right? So from a consultant perspective, you know, we've now got, I would say, a lot more friendly set of rules and frameworks to be able to work with regulators that we haven't before. MAS is, you know, I think everybody here would say, is absolutely outstanding, probably the global leader in where they're sponsoring, you know, various companies, including, you know, some of our Vulcan work, absolutely fantastic. So it's a lot easier for us to, as consultants, to be able to work with what were some of our tower kind of organizations in the past that are now very, very integrated and are wanting to be part of the international scene. So I think first of all, almost, you know, our roles as consultants have been made a lot easier. Second point I make is that, again, you know, as part of the Vulcan platform, we absolutely want to embed regulators into the distributed ledger component of the solution. So, you know, it's not as if we're going to make standards as individual companies or even together necessarily. I think if we get the regulators involved, as I know, associated with that distributed ledger, actually we'll work together to create those standards on a much more agile basis. So I think it's going to be evolutionary and all committed in terms of, you know, distributed related standards.
The thing I have is the question about what role consultants play. And I would say take a deep breath and step out. And the reason I say that is that it would be all too easy for these
three of us up here, each of our firms to be able to develop a proprietary standard we try and settle in the system. Then you have the VHS versus the people kind of fight to the death. I think the reason the internet is successful is open source. And so I think that our digital identity will showcase here at Expo that's going open source, because we say the only way that you actually get standards out there is people in the spirit of innovation, technology innovation, stepping out and going open source for other people in the house. And then with the value of consultants bring is that strategic implementation, the thinking about how you use those standards, which you're not going to get standards if everyone sort of put into the research. As I said,
I think that introduces a
shocking example. Yeah, well, I understand that. You're right. I guess the consultant's dream is that risk of you. Within a consulting firm, you do have the access to regulators, the access to industry, IT, etc. So you can provide that overarching view of how to pull these things together. And I do think that whether it's open source or whether it's new skills and type models, that is an area that's really going to improve the efficiency of reg tech in general. And again, I think consultants can facilitate that by working with the regulators and industry to bring everybody together to run those types of models, provide a strategy around the project management, the dealing with consulting services. Again, having that knowledge across the whole spectrum so that we can help join the dots and make it as efficient as possible.
Mic is working, so with that, we're going to the next question, which is we had sought a lively and informative conversation this afternoon. I think this question goes to that point if it comes up. Well, it was how will the Trump election change the landscape for reg tech? Which clearly, Trump election on the top of the minds around the world, but I think it goes to a more serious point that in a world of maybe less convergence in regulatory frameworks, how can technology help deal with a divergent or fractured world? So anybody have thoughts on reg tech and Trump?
So I think that if you look at the Trump progress through the election, one thing that he made clear was that he will continue to work on the global stage, but he will only do deals with the So all of a sudden you're saying, we're not going to go global first, we're going to go US first. We've already got the EU directing to walk away from Basel. If Basel 4 doesn't go the way that the EU wants, they've said publicly we will walk away. So you're starting to see a fracturing of understanding. Not just on Trump, but it's already out of the way. The reason we have the Trump election, the reason we have Brexit. So in that environment, firms are all really struggling to keep up the pace of regulatory change. We were talking before about how many thousands of regulatory changes that firm has to manage each year. And that number is growing exponentially. Now, we're doing that under the framework of a global Basel standard or a global IT security standard. If people are going to start breaking apart from global standards and you get much more fragmented and fractured of regulations around the world, that problem is just a phase shift. It's still going to grow exponentially.
Yeah, you're right. I think some of the technologies that enable natural language processing that can automate those too. But also, I think the Trump algorithm we've noticed in the last few weeks is probably going to be a much more volatile environment than we might suspect. So I think some of these new technologies to better manage the oversight and compliance in this part, it's just an internal perspective, it's going to become quite important. So that's the files that we saw accrued.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think the whole planet knows what Trump's administration is doing or is going to do, so I'm not too sure answer that one. I would say though that regulation like the global data protection regulation, GDPR, regulation like PSD2, very, very important Euro sort of based regulations. A lot around identity and freeing up identity, controlling identity, a lot around opening up APIs for innovation and creation and next wave technologies. Those paradigm shifts are, from a regulation perspective, changing the market in Europe. There's no doubt about it. People are have to respond rather than putting it in whatever that is. Around the world, you know, people in the US, you know, particularly are looking at and saying, well, at some point I'm going to be probably under that mandate, or I've got a global organization that has offices in those locations. You know, I think the US is going to be a fast follower for some of those things, and those two in particular are great regulations that are going to cause a fierce amount of change in the market, particularly with the financial markets, and that's predominant. So I think, the US will be a fast follower for a lot of this stuff that's going on.
So what are the regulatory compliance challenges that you see in this much more open system? So I think that with these more open source systems, it's a positive if you have standards out there that people are using. The sort of challenges are more going to be some of the cross-border challenges, which is privacy, the ability to transmit data across borders, which in many countries is illegal. So you've got a problem right there. I think the other risks are just, as I said, stepping out of the unknown a little bit, that you might take on an operational risk from you. It is changing the way you understand it, which is also a different mindset. But I think ultimately these global standards are good because you get everyone on the same platform. But one of the biggest problems with global standards that you see is, in fact, if I look at it, use an example of regulation mode. Insurance regulators are trying to be the first ever global insurance companies. So the bars are for insurance. That seems to make sense, right? But if we're receiving widespread, I won't say criticism, the challenges. Because everyone's got their existing systems that they're already using. And when you take legacy systems, which have been probably many decades old in some aspects, how do you actually move them off that one from another?
That's one of those great challenges that we're excited. There are some firms that are looking at using artificial intelligence and other advanced data science techniques to try and bridge that gap and deal with that type of complexity. And that's what we're excited to